It's Warhol.
Yep.
It's Hearst.
Oh, yeah.
It's Botticelli.
Yep.
It's Venus ascending for the 90s, but it's man, and there's no clamshell, and it's a perfect act of genius.
Half man, half prawn, reclining on a corned beef chaise longue. Yes, contemporary art is what I speak of. And half man, half prawn was its searing blade until one balmy night near the end of high summer, a new ace was pulled from the tumbling deck. A trump card was born and then cunningly played. The gallery was rammed and buzzing in high expectation of what was to come. Some said an act of pure existentialism, others a mixture of Dada and Jung. There had been some confusion just by the main door, for a shih tzu had laid a small turd on the floor, and a group from the art school had left their depression, declaring a spontaneous act of expression. In short, it was just too avant-garde. The rumors were running like molten lard. Did the sperm come from Dali? The egg from Fontaine? The artist come surgeon was a fast-breaking name. The surrogate mother knew what was expected, for her broken waters had been shaken and stirred by the funky bartenders, so cool and connected. Frankincense burned as the dour dilettante sipped on his cool embryonic frappe. A heavily pregnant birth mother entered and a bearded philanthropist shouted, "Olé!" Murmurs rose up as she stepped on the canvas, clad in polyandrous birthing smock. A guru's low mantra rang out from the tannoy. The lights were dimmed low until but one single spot illuminated the birth of the innocent child. Tiny, silent, bright on bare white canvas, an act of creation quite second to none. Tiny, silent, bright on bare white canvas, unaware of its role in a cruel world to come. Tarquin Mule, the artist come surgeon, stepped forward and snipped the umbilical cord, and then adjusting his black raw silk surgeon's gown, held the child aloft as though addressing the Lord.
I proclaim this child to be all that is art, and all that is art to be this child. Its name will be art, and so will its nature. So let's kick off the bidding in honor of Nietzsche.
Pepe LeBlanc, the celebrity chef, bore the afterbirth off on a turquoise steel tray. The birth mother, sedated, was put in a car as he feverishly started to flip and flambé. And by the time he had served up his radically chic canapé, the baby boy and blood-stained canvas had been wrapped up and snapped up and driven away. Art's life was brief and uninspiring, because of course everything art touched turned to art. 50 used nappies behind tinted perspex. His first work, it sold for the price of a theme park. Schooled in a gallery cut from glass, a contemporary mariner tied to the mast of his life on a windless sea, poor art became lonely can be. By the age of 20, he'd grossed 12 billion, but at last found love with a girl named Vermilion, who ran her own public relations firm, in which the promotion of art was a sole concern. She told him he was a living god and fed him with pink analgesic pills. She told him whatever he wanted to hear. She was in PR, for fuck's sake. It was her job. And art paid the bills. But oh, what a day! What a catastrophic shock when Art returned home from his self-help group to find his bedroom door firmly locked, the Bentley estate parked behind the wall, the half-empty bottle of vintage Krug, the surgeon's gown on the floor in the hall. He peeked through the keyhole, his heart in his throat, to see Vermilion in flagrante delicto, tied hand and foot with a raw silk rope. And the correspondent, it was plain to see, was Tarquin Mule, his mentor, creator. Yes, Tarquin Mule, that villainous fiend. So on a dark and dusty old factory floor, Art first shed his clothes before bolting the door. He mounted the gibbet of improvised crates, contemplating his life and its tragical fate. He tied up the noose, said a short prayer. Broken-hearted, spent and ruined, he closed his dull eyes and kicked the cold air. But the moment he did, 20 floodlights flashed on, and surrounded he was by a chattering throng of champagne-sipping bourgeoisie, art critics, socialites, national TV and radio crews all there to peruse. But most disgustingly, most disgracefully, most outrageously, Tarquin Mule, powdered and cruel, hemp-clad and nimble, jumped up on a stool.
Witness, my friend, the death of art,
Tarquin said, working the room like a tart. And with snap of his fingers, a black canvas was laid beneath poor twitching Art for his swan song to play. Now it is said, the last gesture of the hanging man is ejaculation. And there, according to Tarquin's heinous plan, the last drops of life spilt forth from Art's quivering form and hit the canvas stark and bare. And there, in his death, his last work was born. It's Warhol. The exhibition lasted 90 days whilst Art turned green and rotted away. Tarquin and Vermilion moved to L.A. and still live there now, I have heard people say. But the moral is clear, and the moral is plain. In this case, I'm afraid only art can be blamed. So believe what you want to, believe who you are, but please make sure that above all else that you never, ever, ever believe in your own PR. On Saturday night played a death metal band to 1,000 demonic screaming fans. And they whipped the fans into a frenzied trance as they howled and screamed and moshed and pranced, and stage diving all seemed such wonderful fun. But Gunther from Frankfurt weighed over a ton.
You rang, sir?
Yes, Long. I'm so terribly, terribly bored.
Shall I wind the victriola for you, sir?
Oh, if you must.